What is a person? If parts of you were to begin to vanish, at what point would you no longer be considered a person? If we know a person is fundamentally made up of individual atoms, is the concept of a person really an illusion? Is there a fundamental structure to reality? What is time, and how does that fit in? These questions are just a few that one might find in metaphysics. Metaphysics is the branch of philosophy that studies what reality is, answering questions like, what is there and what is it like? However, what metaphysics is precisely is controversial and difficult to define, the reason being that this branch of philosophy and what it attempts to solve has changed throughout the centuries. This video will serve as a brief introduction to metaphysics. We'll differentiate between old metaphysics and new metaphysics, examine whether metaphysics is even possible, how science relates to metaphysics, and exciting problems metaphysics hopes to solve. The term metaphysics comes from Aristotle, although he was unfamiliar with the term itself and referred to its subject matter as first philosophy. Around the first century BC in the ancient city of Alexandria, a collection of 14 books by Aristotle, all which dealt with this first philosophy, were translated and published. They were given the title After the Physicals, or The Ones After the Physical Ones. Scholars believe that the title was meant to warn students not to read his books about metaphysics until they mastered the physical ones, or books about regular physics. See, philosophers of that time generally believed the world was how you see it, without any extreme skepticism. They used basic physics to study ordinary causes and ordinary things they saw around them. What is now called old metaphysics, or the metaphysics of Aristotle and his contemporaries until the 17th century, could be thought of as its own field of study, like astrology or biology. Old metaphysics could be thought of as a science that dealt primarily with eternal things. Specifically, Aristotle's metaphysics dealt with the subjects, being as such, the first causes of things, and that which does not change. Some questions Aristotle and the old metaphysicians wrote about include, are abstract objects like math, points, and lines the same type of things as physical objects like chairs? Are being and unity properties of things, and if so, what kind of things are they? Was there a first cause or something that does not change that other causes come from? Two big topics of interest in old metaphysics that still appear today are those of universals and substances. The concept of a universal was thought to help explain why there is so much similarity in the world. For example, why do apples and roses both appear red? Red could be said to be a universal or its own entity showed by different individual things. Other examples include squareness, beauty, or doghood. Substances can be thought of as essences of things that exist all by themselves. Some things, for example, like a hole in a piece of wood, exist in other things, if they even exist at all. But other things, old metaphysics surmised, could exist in their own right. A primary substance could be certain types of things, like an individual horse. Secondary substances include the species under which the primary substance falls, such as horse or man. Philosophy underwent a significant change in the 17th century and ushered in what could be called new metaphysics. Problems that used to belong to traditional physics began to be reassigned to metaphysics. New metaphysics can be said to have started with René Descartes, who some consider to be the father of modern philosophy. With his Cartesian skepticism, Descartes questioned what we could truly know. Although unlikely, what if a powerful demon were tricking our senses, making it seem that what was reality was something else? The modern version of this argument is, what if we're just a brain in a vat being fed information that makes it seem like we have arms, legs, and live in reality? Until Descartes, philosophers generally took the world to be what it was. But now, since we can't know for sure what is real, Descartes wrote, we need a stable foundation of knowledge before we can create metaphysical systems. After all, it's through knowledge that metaphysicians claim to be able to say what reality is. Descartes, who was what is called a continental rationalist, believed that one could come to rational, obvious conclusions about what reality is, and thus begin building metaphysical reality systems off of those basic conclusions. His cogito ergo sum, or I think therefore I am conclusion, to his skeptical problem gave him a foundation to build on. Although his rational conclusions are heavily contested, the idea of whether metaphysics is even real or worth studying began to be questioned. It was a topic of main concern throughout the coming centuries. So before we proceed any further, we should probably ask whether metaphysics can be done at all. Skepticism of the ability to do metaphysics only increased after Descartes with the British empiricists of the 17th and 18th century, including John Locke, George Berkeley, and David Hume. For instance, one of the great epistemological skeptics, 18th century empiricist Hume, argued that knowledge and truths could only come from two sources. These were relations of ideas, or matters of fact in real existence, an idea referred to as Hume's fork. Relations of ideas refer to knowledge discovered by the mere operation of thought, like all bachelors are unmarried, or those of algebra and arithmetic, like 2 plus 2 equals 4. Matters of fact refer to empirical knowledge about the world, which we derive from perception and science, like it's raining outside. Like a fork, both prongs can't touch, meaning matters of fact can't influence relations of ideas, and vice versa. For any other type of knowledge, including metaphysical theories, Hume declared committed then to the flames, for it can contain nothing but sophistry and illusion. Immanuel Kant took up Hume's challenge of metaphysical claims, but simply came to what could be said to be a lighter conclusion that metaphysics couldn't fully be done. Kant attempted to combine rational, or what he called a priori knowledge, with empirical, or what he called a posteriori knowledge, with his idea of synthetic a priori knowledge. Synthetic a priori knowledge meaning simply how our minds organize the data of the senses. His doctrine of transcendental idealism stated that conscious subjects cognize the objects of experience not as they are in themselves, but only the way they appear to us under the conditions of our sensibility. Kant believed there is a reality beyond sense data, which he called the noumena, but unfortunately we can never really know it, only in ways it appears to us in our minds. Skepticism that metaphysics was not possible continued into the 20th century. With the logical positivist movement, philosophers including A.J. Ayer and those in the Vienna Circle School of Thought believed that only statements verifiable through direct observation or logical proof are meaningful. The meaning of a statement was its prediction of observable results of an experiment. Thus, there's no need to postulate the existence of any objects other than those basic observations. In other words, there's no need to do metaphysics since metaphysical claims require more knowledge than what can be learned in an observable experiment. It hasn't been until the last few decades that metaphysics has been reborn. Logical positivism and pure empiricism proved to be self-defeating philosophies. Ayer himself stated that the most important defect of logical positivism was that nearly all of it was false. After all, the statement that only statements which can be verified by experience are meaningful is in itself not verifiable. The work of epistemological skeptics help us realize that pure verifiable knowledge is fully impossible since subjects perceive the world. But we can have partial knowledge of things which can then be used to help make metaphysical claims and understand reality better. So science and empiricism haven't replaced metaphysics. But what exactly is metaphysics' relationship with science as of today? Maybe a more important question is, what exactly is the job of new metaphysics today and how should it work? Some metaphysicians believe the job of metaphysics is to run parallel with science. Philosopher Arthur Fine believes metaphysics should provide theories of which facts or propositions hold in reality and are the grounds for other facts and propositions. Philosopher Ted Sider believes metaphysics should strive to explain the world in terms of an underlying fundamental structure. Most metaphysicians today would refer to themselves as physicalists. Physicalism is the metaphysical theory that states that there's an objective reality that everyone shares, and this reality we all interact in is governed by just nature and a set of natural laws. All the rest to reality are fundamentally mindless arrangements or interactions of matter and energy in space-time, which can be learned through systematic experimentation and science. Metaphysics relates to science as it continues asking why questions where science study leaves off. For example, a scientific theory is that electrons have a charge which can be tested, and that's where science ends. Metaphysics then enters and explores this topic in science, asking things like, can an electron's identity change over time? If it changes, is it the same particle? What's an electron's relationship to, say, the concept of time? Imre Lakatos, a Hungarian-born philosopher of mathematics and science, explained that theories in science must have a metaphysical hard core to them, which then are used to generate theories and new hypotheses. Science and metaphysics work hand in hand, and as he stated, scientific changes are connected with vast, cataclysmic metaphysical revolutions. A popular example of metaphysics in action today is the simulation theory hypothesis, a theory put forth recently by Nick Bostrom, that our reality is just a simulation formed by a post-human or more advanced civilization. Scientific experiments have been drawn up to test this hypothesis, although unlikely to yield anything. If such experiments did happen to discover evidence, one could easily see how that would lead to more metaphysical theories and more serious experiments and perhaps even new branches of science. However, as stated before, there's still no agreement on what new metaphysics precisely is and what it should specifically do. For some philosophers, metaphysics is just a catch-all term covering topics that can't precisely fit into other branches of philosophy, like ethics, logic, and epistemology. Perhaps the best way to define modern metaphysics is to go over some of the big questions it tackles and hopes to solve. I'll go over several different topics, but there are many more like this, and many of these topics overlap with each other. Number one, those of ontology, or a branch of metaphysics that studies being and existence exclusively. Ontologists try to determine things about being, like how we group similar things into basic categories. For example, we notice many things are white, like the snow or a dog. What exactly is white? Is it what's called a universal, its own thing that appears on many individual things? Or do universals not exist, only individual things that have a resemblance? It also attempts to answer things like which of these entities exists on the most fundamental level. For example, take the question from the start, what's a person? Isn't a person just a large group of cells, but then aren't cells just atoms? Does that mean a person is simply an illusion and fundamentally just atoms in a certain arrangement? Another example is the philosophy of mind. In a world that appears to just be nature and natural laws, where does the human mind fit in? What is consciousness? Two main schools of thought throughout the centuries have been dualism and monism. Dualism, which originated with René Descartes, postulated that the mind was a separate type of substance from everything else. Dualists include those who believe in property dualism, like panpsychists, who believe reality is just one substance, but with physical and mental properties that help explain why conscious beings have subjective experiences. Monists believe mind and matter are exactly the same kind of thing. This includes physicalism, among others, the idea that the mind can be explained and reduced to some way to the workings of matter in the body. Physicalism is perhaps the most common theory of mind now, but even within this branch, there are arguments and various theories. Metaphysics also deals with causation, determinism, and free will. Was there a single causal event for all of existence? Do causes happen between two events, like a boat hitting an iceberg and sinking, or just two entities or things, like the boat and the iceberg? If things are all caused by previous factors, how can we have free will to make our own choices? Causal determinism suggests that events within a given paradigm are bound by causality, so that prior states completely determine any state of an object or event. Simply put, the state of the universe right now determines what happens next regardless of our will. Is it possible for us to have free will despite causal determinism? This is what is called compatibilism. Or is free will fully an illusion, a stance called incompatibilism? Space and time are another issue in new metaphysics. What exactly are space and time and their properties? An example metaphysical problem regarding time is the direction of time. Physics appears to show that the laws of nature are time reversal invariant. Think of a film that illustrates a law of nature happening like gravity and then it being played backward. It would still portray a physical possible process. However, our experience of time at the macroscopic level seems to have time moving in just one direction. Why does time appear to flow in only one direction? Does it not flow at all, but we can only recall the past in our mind, making it seem as though it's one directional? Another issue is that of abstract objects and concepts. What are seemingly spaceless and timeless things, like properties, relations, and concepts like math or probability in their relation with space and time? For example, if there is absolutely no space and time, can there be a possibility for space and time to exist? Or do concepts like possibility need a framework of time to even be a thing? Many other metaphysical problems have played out throughout the centuries and continue to this very day. Now, hopefully, this short video gave you at least a basic understanding of what metaphysics is and what it attempts to do. In conclusion, as stated before, metaphysics has, in a way, just started over again. It's been revived from the clutches of global epistemological skepticism. Once again, it's being embraced as a tool in philosophy that helps us make sense of important questions humanity keeps asking, like, who are we and what is real? So if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and make sure to subscribe for more videos like it using the link in the description and turn on the notification bell to receive updates when new videos come out. So again, hopefully you like this little video introduction on metaphysics, and I'll see you again in another video.